Lean back. Lean back. Hello, internets. This is Olin from What I'm Listening To. I have just returned from a long day at work, and typically when I do return from work, I'm stressed and I'm exhausted, and I like to unwind to some ambience music. As a lot of you already know, I am a huge fan of experimental music, and experimental music is just kind of a broad term to describe different styles of music. Amongst those styles is ambient music, which is typically very calming and beautiful and abstract and something that you can kind of zone out to and just kind of forget your surroundings and just focus heavily on whatever you're listening to. I have here a stack of wonderful ambient albums that I'm very excited to show you, so with that being said, let's get going. So the first things I'm going to show you, they're all by the same guy, they're just all different releases. It would not be an ambient vlog if I did not talk about him, but I have here an assorted amount of Brian Eno records. Brian Eno is the man responsible for ambient music. He's just an early pioneer of ambient music. He is the reason why it's popular and it's incorporated in so much music to this day. Most notably, he did a series of albums that are just known as the Ambient Series, and I have 1, 2, and 4. So we have the first one here. This is Music for Airports. This one is probably his most famous of the ambient albums. Pretty much anybody who talks about Brian Eno will likely talk about this album. It's only 4 songs, and each song ranges from about 10 minutes to 16 minutes, but they're just these slow, nice, beautiful songs that are all inspired by when Eno was traveling through airports. Considering that I was getting into ambient music, I thought that I needed to go back to the basics and just hear this album for itself and really get to know it. So after I listened to that one, I moved on to ambient number 2. This is The Plateau of Mirror. This one is actually a collaboration between Brian Eno and this avant-garde pianist named Harold Budd, who I've listened to some of his work. He does amazing work, just as good as Eno. But the two have come together. Harold Budd's on the piano, and Brian Eno does keyboards and tape loops. And this record, if anything, reminds me a lot of the Minecraft soundtrack. Or rather, I should say, I believe the composer of the Minecraft soundtrack was probably listening to this record when he was working with Minecraft. The tape loops that Brian Eno has on here just add a whole other layer of depth to all the songs. It's more than 4 songs, I believe there's 10 or 11 on here, but it's a beautiful record. And a funny story about this one, I actually bought it off of Discogs, and for whatever reason, the seller decided to ship it to Tennessee as opposed to my apartment in San Francisco. But then eventually Amoeba had a copy of it, and I just decided I needed to get it because I really enjoyed it. So this is a beautiful record. And then this one, this is the 4th and final one. I didn't get the 3rd one, mostly because I couldn't find it, but also because the 3rd one is technically not a Brian Eno album. It's a album that was produced by Brian Eno. But this one, the 4th one, this is On Land, and this one, he dives into some dark ambient elements. So dark ambient is what it sounds like. It's ambient music, it's calming, it's soothing, but it also just has these kind of darker, creepier elements to it. Lizard Point was the first song I heard off this. It's actually the first track on here. And after I heard that, I thought, okay, I need to check this one out because it just sounds so spooky in comparison to the stuff that he's done in the past. So this is the last one in the Ambient series. It's just as good as the other two that I've shown. And despite the fact that it's creepier, it's still gorgeous. Thank you. the last Brian Eno album I have is yet another collaboration. This is Brian Eno and Robert Fripp, who's better known as the guitarist to King Crimson. Just based on hearing King Crimson's music and hearing Brian Eno's music, it's very different, but considering that they have collaborated on one album, it just sounded so interesting to me. I imagined it to be just like the second Ambient album with Brian Eno on piano and tape loops and Robert Fripp just adding layers of guitar work. And it is just that, and it's so good. The last song, well technically it's the last five songs, but this is a remaster so they split the last song into five different tracks. 28 minutes of just this crazy buildup, this crescendo of noise only to just go down and start to calm down, and it's just amazing. It's amazing. This is a great record along with all these others. Brian Eno is the man. He's just such an amazing composer, and these barely scratch the surface of his discography. He's got so much material, but I'm just happy to have all these in my collection. Okay, so let's move on to some non-Brian Eno ambient music. This album right here, this is Sigur Rós's very first album, Vaughn. Most people know Sigur Rós for their second album that has a title that I can't pronounce, but it's the blue one with the baby. That is a gorgeous record. That could be technically an ambient record, but it's more post-rock than anything. So before they decided to do post-rock music, they made this record, and this one is just kind of all over the place and is just so different from everything. I say it's an ambient record, but there's also elements of shoegaze, drone, some post-rock elements, but I categorize it mostly as an ambient record because there's a couple tracks on here that are just, they just sound like they're field recordings in a forest with some layers of tape loops being played. I think this is an album that a lot of Sigur Rós fans tend to ignore just because of how different it sounds. But considering that I'm into experimental music, I wanted to hear this one myself, and what also sold me was the cover, just this creepy baby face. I recommend you check it out if you know of Sigur Rós and are familiar with their later stuff. You should maybe check this one out to see what you think. Okay, next up here, I have an album. It's called The Body Lovers. This is actually a side project by Michael Gira from Swans, and his inspiration behind it was he wanted to make a soundtrack to a movie that didn't exist. And the selling point for this album for me was he described it as psychoambient. Considering how Swans already is really creepy and abrasive and just, their music is something else. I really wanted to hear Michael Gira's take on ambient music. And the fact that there's a severed head of a pig on the cover just made it that much more interesting to me. But if it's anything like how it was described, I'm sure that I will get a kick out of it. Next record I have here, this is a Tim Hecker album. This is his album Mirages. Tim Hecker's turning into one of those guys who I just slowly but surely grab an album from his discography and get it just to have it because his music is so good. And a lot of it varies too. His later stuff is much more electronic oriented, but there's other albums he does where they're more droning. There's some that are more focused on the ambience. There's some that are more glitchy. And then there's this one, which is ambient, but it's also a lot noisier. Alien 8 Recordings, which is the label that put this one out, described it as a death metal ambient album in the making. That description alone was enough for me to look into this. Because thinking about it, I can't say that I've really come across a death metal ambient band, so I just thought I should check this one out. Man, was I happy I did, because this is probably my new favorite Tim Hecker album. It's just so awesome. I love the noise of it, and I love the fact that it's just him playing guitar and then taking those recordings and just fucking with them and making these incredible sounds. Yet again, another amazing cover. That was another selling point. It's just very, very creepy. So yeah, Tim Hecker, Mirage is probably my new favorite Tim record, maybe until I hear another one of his albums, but I love this one and I think it's worth checking out. And the final album I have here, this is a 3-disc compilation of a band called Amp. I grabbed this one mostly because I didn't realize that a physical copy of it existed. I had it digitally for a while, but I stumbled across the physical copy and I just had to own it. Although I referred to Amp as a band, it's technically one dude, Richard Amp, and he collaborates with a bunch of other musicians, and amongst those are Matt Elliott of the Third Eye Foundation and my favorite guy, Dave Pierce of Flying Saucer Attack. That's probably the main reason why I got this one, is because there is one song that Dave contributes. Matt Elliott has a bunch of cuts on here, but Dave's song is so amazing. They also do a phenomenal cover of Scarborough Fair on the 3rd disc CDP. Every song on here is just so indulging and, like all the other ambient albums I showed you, just gorgeous and so easy to kind of just lose your sense of reality to. If you haven't heard Amp's music, I highly recommend it. It's just great ambient music that incorporates elements of space rock, shoegaze, and all the stuff that any experimental fan would love, like myself. Okay, internet, that does it for me. Hey, if you have any albums, bands, songs you want me to check out, leave a comment down below, and if I like it, maybe I'll feature it in a vlog. But until then, this is Olin from What I'm Listening To, signing out. Goodbye.